in relationship with another, memory is there. What is the action of not letting memory intrude? Is it to see its presence as it arises and drop it instantly, or should one be in a state where memory does not arise its head unless necessary? I'll read the question again more slowly. In relationship with another, please, we are listening to the question, not reacting to your relationship. Bene. Your wife is sitting next to you. Don't react. It's very difficult. It's a rummy world, isn't it? In relationship with another, memory is there. What is the action of not letting memory intrude? Is it to see its presence as it arises and drop it instantly? Or should one be in a state where memory does not raise its head unless necessary? Right? Have you got the question? Have you got the question? Shall I read it again? Do you want me to read it again? Bene. In relationship with another, memory is there. What is the action of not letting memory intrude? Is it to see its presence as it arises and drop it instantly? Or should one be in a state where memory does not raise its head unless necessary? What is the question? The question is, in our relationship with each other, intimate or not, memory is there, right? It's always there. Because I'm living with that, one is living with that person. Cooking, sex, washing up. This speaker has done a lot of washing up. Wherever he goes, he washes up. Except in India. There they won't allow it. Now, the actual state in our relationship with another is the activity of memory. There is no refutation of that. That is so, right? Do you all agree to that? No? You're not sure. Is not our relationship based on recognition? Word, my wife, my husband. what she said this morning. He was moody. He only looked at the newspaper, never looked at me. He's concerned about his job. So that's the memory in operation. Nobody can deny that. What is the action, the questioner says, of not letting memory intrude? Memory is there, right? It's not a question of memory intruding, right? The question is put wrongly. That is, there is another conclusion that memory should not intrude in relationship. You follow? You have already come to that conclusion by listening to the speaker and saying, yes, quite right, memory should not intrude. Then you say to me, ask the question, how is it possible? You put a wrong question, then you answer it wrongly. Right? Let's get that clear. We live with memories, not only with regard to our intimate relationship with another, but also the long series of memories which we have accumulated through time. The racial memory, the linguistic memory, social memory, legislative memory, the memories of having read books. This whole accumulation of memories from childhood and the racial memories which has been impressed upon you, and so on. So we have memories. We are memories. Right? Let's be clear on this point. We are past and present memories, and also the future memories, unless there is a catharsis or a crisis and so on arises. So memories of the past, the present and the future is what we are. Traditionally, religiously, socially and so on. Class, economics and so on. I won't go into all this, repeat it over and over again. So we are memories. And she adds to that memory. Or he adds to that memory. So we are all the time accumulating memories. Not that memories intrude, right? When you say that memories should not intrude, it is another form of memory. Have we understood? Because you have heard the speaker says, in relationship, knowledge is a danger, knowledge is an impediment, that you have accepted. Or you see that. And you say, now how am I to prevent that memory intruding? But you are a bundle of memory. You don't want that particular memory with your wife or husband to intrude. There you want a good relationship. But elsewhere, it doesn't matter. Right? The questioner asks, Is it to see its present, that is, the memory arising, and as it arises, drop it instantly? In relationship. You understand? Have you understood him? Come on. Somebody say whether yes or no, whether you understand it or not. Or should one be in a state where memory does not raise its head unless necessary? This is a very complicated question, right? And requires not a complicated brain, but a very simple brain can observe this. I'm going to show it in a minute. I am and you are memories, a bundle of memories. Even if you say there is in me God, light, sense of spirituality, it is still memory. So I am the whole structure of the ego, me, and all my knowledge is memory. Now I see in my relationship with my wife or husband or children or neighbor, these memories are always included. The memory of my wife who said something nasty or bullied me or said something pleasant or exciting, is still, I've gathered that memory, right? So the question is, are you following all this? Question is, why does the brain retain all these memories? Right? Would you ask that question? Right, sir? Why does the brain retain something pleasant she has told me and something unpleasant which she said yesterday that also is recorded. Both pleasant and unpleasant are recorded, which becomes memory, right? Why does the brain record? That is the question. You understand? There's been a war 40 years ago, and they write books about it, they're talking about it. They show on the television various exciting scenes about war, various material for destruction, you know. Kept up, keep this going all the time. Why? You understand? We'll not go into it. So we are asking a much more serious, fundamental question. Why does the brain record everything? Why should it record the unpleasant and the pleasant? Unpleasant, it is in a state of constant recording, right? We agree to this? This is a fact, not the speaker's invention. Now the question is, it is necessary to record how to drive a car, right? How to write a letter, to be skillful in using instruments, to have knowledge in dismantling a car and putting it together, which the speaker has done. So it is necessary there, right? Now, why does it record psychologically, inwardly? You got the question? We are asking this question. Is it necessary to record the pleasant, the unpleasant, the flattery, the insult, the sense of, you know, all the rest of it. Is it necessary? Or the psychological recording gives strength, builds up the ego, the me, the personality. You understand? See that? Recording is necessary. Otherwise, we couldn't do anything in the physical world. If you are a businessman, you have to know quite a lot. If you are a banker, you have to know a great deal. If you are a surgeon or a doctor, I especially, goodness, you follow? Or a builder of computers, you must know a great deal. There, it is absolutely necessary. Right? Now we're asking, inwardly, inside the skin as it were, which is the psyche, the psychological area, why should there be any recording there? Is it an extension of the outer physical necessities into the psychological necessity? Is an extension of that? Is it an extension of that? You understand? Is it a continuity of the outer knowledge which is necessary? And we say psychologically also it is necessary. We never questioned it. You understand what I'm saying? Are we two somewhat together in this? Surely you're not paralyzed, are you? So please, I'm not hypnotizing you. So we are questioning the whole recording process. When I see that what she has said this morning is not important, is not necessary, she will say something different tomorrow. I will say something to her, something entirely different. Right? We both play this game. And what does it matter? Is it necessary? Which means I am building an image about her, and she is building an image about me, a picture about me. The picture, the image, the symbol becomes very strong. Right? You know this, don't you? Becomes tremendously strong. Therefore, I say, she's like that. And she says, I'm like that. And we keep apart, except perhaps in bed. And the division grows wider and wider and wider. And I break, or she breaks, and I pursue another woman and start the same old game again there. And she does exactly the same thing. Right? Do you agree to all this? The much married people? So this is going on. And we are saying, in examining the question, the inevitable question arises, is it possible not to record psychologically? What does it mean? Can this happen, this mechanical process? It is a mechanical process. The brain has become accustomed to it. It's part of its tradition. It's part of its continuation of sustaining itself as the self, right? So, we're asking, is it possible? Record there, where it is absolutely necessary not to record at all, psychologically. Don't you see the beauty of this, for God's sake? Which means, first of all, see the danger of recording psychologically. I'm a Hindu. You are a Christian, right? You're a Buddhist or Tibetan or belonging to some potty little guru. You may have a lot of money, a lot of power, position, but it's still a very potty little affair. So you see all of this. So we're asking, is it possible not to record inwardly? What's your answer? I put you a question. You have put me several questions. But I'm putting you a question. Is it possible not to record psychologically? Which means not to get hurt. Or flattered. Same thing. You may say it is possible, or you might say it's not possible. If you say either of those things, you're blocking yourself, right? Right? If you say, I can't walk up that mountain, you've stopped walking. But if you say, well, I'll walk, see what happens, that's then totally different. Action takes place. So, what's your answer? The question's answer is this. Are you aware of anything? Aware of the shape of this tent? How many sections there are in this tent? The printed word of the order of the tent there. Are you aware of all this? The proportions of it, the length of it, not measuring, the length of it. And are you aware of the people sitting around you? The various colors, the faces, different faces, young, old, white hair, black hair, so on. Are you aware of all this? Or you have never looked? Because if you are not aware, then you may not be aware of your own reaction. You may not be aware of your own responses. You may not be aware of your body, because you're terribly intellectual living up there. Or you're very romantic. Are you aware of all the sentimental, attached, and so on? If you're aware, not say, well, I'm aware, but I don't like that shirt. It's too blue. So I was told this morning. So are we aware in that sense, without choosing, a choiceless awareness. Then, if you are so choicelessly aware, then you are attentive, understand? Choiceless awareness means attention, not cultivated. Say, I must attain. But becoming aware of the trees, the birds, the balloons going up, the mountains, the light on the clouds, the evening, the moonlight and so on. Watching, aware of all this and your reaction to all this. And by not responding, not choosing, I like this, I don't like that. It's mine, it's your, you follow? Just to be aware. From that choiceless awareness, there is attention. Right? Attending with your eyes, with your ears, with your nerves, with all your being. Then, when she says something to me, I'm fully attentive. Right? She says, you are a brute. Because I'm attentive, there's no reaction, you understand? It's only when there is inattention, there is reaction. Get it? Gosh, it takes a long time to tell all this. I've got this. When there is complete attention, there is no recording. But I must completely attend there. In driving a car, I must be tremendously attentive. Attention is there and here, attention. But the moment when I am inattentive to what she is saying, it's recorded naturally. You got it? Will you do it? That's the fun, not just listen to a lot of words, but when I actually puts, you know, not into action, see the truth of it. Then there is no recording, but if you record, if you inattentively record, then you can deal with it instantly. But if you're constantly inattentive, as we are, in our relationship with another, because it's our habit. I've known her for 40 years, for God's sake. Or 10 days. You understand? So the quality of attention and the quality of inattention, not attending, are two different things. Where there is inattention, there is choice, unawareness, lack of attention. Then the recording process goes on. The old habit is established. But when there is attention, the old habit is broken. Got it?